Welcome to New Earth Lifestyles. I'm JaneE King, your hostess of the show today. Glad you're with us here in downtown Manchester, New Hampshire, manchestertv.org, in these beautiful studios provided by Manchester TV, Manchester Public Television. It's a beautiful day in downtown Manchester in May 28, 2015. I am with you talking about things that you may have never considered before as a way of looking at a new life, a new perspective on life, a new way of looking at how you can improve whatever's going on in your life, whether it's your relationships, your health, your vocation. I'm here to help you understand and look at new ways of looking at life. And in the future, I have invited a new host that will be here next week. She was unable to come this week. My friend Christiana Rodriguez. She is down in Florida right now at a conference, but she came on last week, and I introduced her as the new host of New Earth Lifestyles. And I'm sorry she couldn't be here today, so I am still here. But she will be with us next week and moving forward on every Thursday. And she will be hopefully carrying forward this idea of this mission that I have. She may not. She may tweak it a little bit based on her direction and her focus and her healing abilities. She is a healer here in Manchester or in Bedford, I guess. And that will be some new blood. We're looking at new stuff, and newness is a good thing. My life is shifting and changing, and this show morphing into the next phase in that way is one of those changes. So we say one door closes, another door opens. That's where I am in my life right now. My studio in New London, I'm also going to be leaving, as the owner of the property has wanted to repurpose the studio I've been renting. So there's another change happening in my life where my Medicine Drum studio will be moving somewhere, and I'm not sure exactly where, but perhaps it will be moving to Claremont to a friend of mine's studio called Ahimsa Yoga Center on North Street. A lot of change is happening, and you know, change is really good. We get in ruts, we get in these modes of wanting things to be the same. I'm the same way. I've been living in my apartment, the same apartment now for 6 years. That's a long time to be in the same place for some people. Because change can be difficult, I kind of get settled in and comfortable, and you know, you end up accumulating things, and you don't want to move once you've accumulated a lot of things. My studio, however, I have been cleaning out little at a time and finding homes for things. I do have a few more things to clean out of my studio. And talking about my drum making, because the studio is my drum making studio, June 12th will be my last drum making workshop at Medicine Drum Studio on Page Road in New London. If you'd like to get in on that workshop, you can take my website, which is on your screen, go there, and there is an events page, and you can learn all about my next drum making workshop, which is June 12th. It's a Friday. Good day to take off. Take off a Friday, make it a long weekend, make your drum, and then you'll have a nice new instrument for the rest of your life. And I brought a drum kit here today, a small drum, to kind of give you a flavor for what drum making is all about. I have with me this nice little hoop. This is a 10-inch hand-bent hoop. I think it's ash. I'm not really totally sure. But what I was going to do was do a little demonstration. I brought a hide. I brought some lacing. I was going to do a quick little demonstration showing you the tools and what it entails to make a medicine drum, a Native American hoop drum. Now, a drum is the most primitive instrument. It was the first instrument. Pardon me. The first instrument. I need to probably drink something. Sorry about that. Let me take a quick break of liquid. This is my homemade concoction of tea. So a drum is a symbol. If you look at the circle, at the hoop, it's a circle, right? Sure. It's a circle. I can get it to stay in place now. And there's no beginning, there is no end, perfectly round. That is the circle of life. That is the symbol of the circle of life. No beginning, no end. That's what a drum made in this manner is all about, a circle. No beginning, no end. When you make a drum with me, we honor the hoop, we honor the parts of the drum, the wood, the in this case, ash tree. We get in touch with the spirit of the ash tree. And we give thanks to that. We have gratitude. It's a heightening experience to make a drum because we have gratitude for everything that we're doing throughout the day. And you have an opportunity to bring all the realms of the other unseen worlds of your angels, your guides, your ancestors, your spirit animals, your totem animals, come into this process of making a drum. When you handle the hoop, you have a chance to write a prayer or your name in the hoop. If you wanted to paint your hoop, you could. The hide we use, the hide we're going to use this week, or actually, I'm sorry, June 12th, is a horse hide. And these horse hides came from natural deaths. They were not put to death. It's a natural dying process, and then the animals then their hide is then saved. And so when we work with, on June 12th, the horse hide, we will be honoring the spirit and the spirit of that animal. We will be connecting with that animal through a journey process. I will be using my drum that's already made and drumming, taking you on a journey to a meadow to interact with the spirit of this horse that will be happening in your mind's eye, in your imagination, in an internal, inward journey. When you do this, it is very, very powerful. You will have an opportunity to communicate with that horse. You'll have an opportunity to talk to that horse and ask questions of that spirit animal. And if your spirit horse or your totem animal is horse medicine, this would be an amazing opportunity for you to truly get more information about your journey on this earth plane now, to connect in with the horse spirit and enhance your own spiritual growth process. So this is a spiritual journey, a spiritual process. Some of the tools we'll be using are a hole punch. This is a hole punch. You'll be punching holes in the hide. Another tool we'll be using is scissors. And then here is the hide that we would be using. If you can keep that close up, that would be good. So we have, this is horse hide that's already been cut, or it may be elk hide, I'm not sure, but it's already, what we'll be doing is cutting the hide. Let's see if I can put it in front so you can see it. We'll be cutting the hide like this, which becomes the lace. And then we will be taking this, and I brought out a little towel because it's a little damp. And this is a soaked horse hide. Let me rearrange a little bit more here. I'll pull this over to here. And this hide has been soaked in water. It would normally be stiff like this, like the lacing. But it's been soaked in water, and so we will be taking this hoop and we will be putting this hide over this hoop. See how it nicely it drapes over, and it would become a beautiful drum, a beautiful sacred drum. Now what would we be doing with the hole punch is when we'll be making holes in this hide by, I like to fold it in half, and then I would punch the hole. And once you get the hole punched, you'd get holes punched all the way around the edge here, all the way around this edge. We'd punch holes, and then we would lay it on the hoop and lace the hide with the lacing. And that would be your beautiful new horsehide drum. So if you're interested in this process, please do contact me on my website, which is on your TV screen right now. I'm going to put this back in here because it's a little bit on the damp side still. And you can make a 15-inch, this is a 10-inch, but you could make a 15-inch horse hide drum, horse medicine. And why do we call it horse medicine or medicine drum? Medicine, from my perspective, from the indigenous cultures of the earth, is spirit power. The power of your spirit, the power of the horse spirit, the power of my spirit, the power of the spirit of the tree. Everything, everything is energy. Everything has a spirit or an energy to it, a consciousness, you could say. And so medicine, the original medicine, is that energy, is that consciousness, is that spirit, that vibration that is imbued, is in everything. When you make a medicine drum, your medicine, your spirit, your intention goes into your drum. You are also working with the hide, the horse hide in this instance, the spirit, the medicine of that horse, the spirit of that horse. Horse medicine for some people is power, like horsepower, right? We govern our car power by horsepower, because originally horses were the mode of transportation. And so many horses, if you have 300 horsepower, that's actually the power of 300 horses pulling something. That's how that label got on a car, because it's that many horses pulling something. That's the power of that car. So when you make your own horse medicine drum, that power of the horse, that strength, that courage, that ability to persevere and keep on going, is the medicine that is going into this process and into your personal drum, your personal medicine drum. So you're melding the medicine of the horse with your medicine, the medicine of the tree, not only those things, but also the elements of the water. As you saw, this hide was soft and flexible because I'd been soaking it in water. It has to rehydrate because when it's once it's dried, it's hard like this. This is the lacing that's hard. It's dry, even though it's a little bit bendable. If it were a big piece of hide, it would be hard and flat. Once it's hydrated with water, it becomes soft and pliable. So we have also in the drum the spirit of the water, the medicine of water. We also have the medicine of the air, right? Because the drum will be drying, and the air will then take the water out of the drum as the drum hardens and becomes a good tone. So we have the spirit and the medicine of air. We also have the spirit of earth. Earth that makes the tree, that helps the tree to grow. It helps us to grow. It feeds the horse when the horse is free on the pasture or on the plains. So then we have the medicine of earth. We also have the medicine of fire, of the sun, because the sun is involved in everything. It's involved in the earth and the health of the earth, in making trees and making us, and the air and everything that we have depends on the sun, on the fire. So the spirit of all these things, these elements, is part of the medicine that goes into the drum. Now, how do we translate medicine of this nature, of this very primal nature, to the medicine of what we do in our pharmaceutical, say, medicine? Well, I believe that what has happened is a translation from the truth of what medicine is has been translated into a chemical equation, into a chemistry, making that what we call our medicine today. Whereas originally, medicine was, and in some cultures still is, all that is: the earth, the air, the fire, the water, the trees, the animals, us, everything. And a lot of the medicine has to do with our thoughts and the consciousness and what we call in the Western world God. which the indigenous cultures called Great Spirit, or the unseen, or great mystery. They had other words. We call all that there is God. And perhaps that is the most powerful medicine, God. I'm going to move on now from the drum making. I'm going to move into an area of earth healing, because the drum is very, very, very instrumental in healing the earth. When you make a drum and then you go to a circle, a drum circle, or if you take your drum, you just drum with your drum wherever you live, you drum a beat. The beat of that drum and your connection, your heartbeat, the drum's beat, you synchronize. That beat and that connection then connects with the earth's heartbeat, and the earth can feel that. I believe that the earth is a living consciousness, and we are living on the earth as smaller pieces of her, our Mother Earth consciousness. From that perspective, we have a lot of power, which is very, very fitting to be talking about horsepower. We have a lot of power if we were to understand our own power, which is the light, which is the fact that we are conscious beings, that we are of God, we are of Great Spirit, we are medicine people, all of us, in our thoughts, in our way of believing, in our way of living our lives day to day. On that note, I would like to turn to a couple of articles that a friend of mine wrote, and he just emailed them to me last night, and I read them this morning, and they just seem so appropriate to what I was going to talk about today, which is drums and earth and healing the earth and healing ourselves, because drums are the primal way of healing ourselves through the drum beat. My friend Saul Solomon, he was on my show a couple times last year. He comes from Sutton, New Hampshire, and he's been working with homeopathy all of his life, but he is very passionate about healing the earth and helping the earth heal. So he wrote this letter to the editor, I believe, to the Concord Monitor, and it was published on February 28th, 2015, not long ago. He has titled this, My Turn. First things first, it's time to outlaw war. Time to outlaw war. By Saul Solomon for the Monitor. That's the Concord Monitor, I believe. Humanity has the look of a dying species. Terrorism has invaded our collective body like a cancer. And we are closer to global catastrophe from environmental stress than ever before. The Bulletin of Atomic Scientists tells us, quote, the window for action is closing rapidly, end quote. While horrendous acts of terror continue to escalate, we are waging war on the planet as well. We behave as if we want to ensure we do not survive and do not care if we take the rest of life on Earth with us. Something is very wrong with humankind. People are willing to strap on suicide vests and slaughter innocents, have lost all sense of their own humanity. Our core is diseased. And if we don't heal ourselves as a species, the prognosis is not good. In terms of wealth distribution, the richest 80 individuals, that's 80, 80 individuals own as much of the wealth as half of the planet's population. And it's in their interest to foster war because the production of arms is a sure way to make more money. While most thinking people, are alarmed by this dire situation, there's no consensus on what to do. The Occupy movement, spawned by Wall Street excesses, temporarily called attention to the imbalance. But that seems to have fizzled out. The United Nations is mired in hopeless political squabbling and appears unable to exert any meaningful collective will to change. 2/3 of Americans are so turned off by the political system that they don't even bother to vote. So what can be done? In the film, the 1951 film, The Day the Earth Stood Still. Any of you remember that? It's a little before my time, but anyway, it's still available. The 1951 film, The Day the Earth Stood Still, suggests one possible approach and an idea. I watch this film every few years as a reminder of what might be possible. Directed by Robert Wise, it reflects the tensions existing at the onset of the Cold War in Russia. For the first time, humans had harnessed nuclear energy to make bombs and had used them against each other. In the film, an alien named Klaatu from a highly developed planet lands in Washington, D.C. to deliver a message. Join us and live in peace, or pursue your present course and face obliteration, was his comment, his message. Klaatu explains that people on his planet are free of aggression and war because they have outlawed them. Any people forcing others to do things against their will are simply eliminated. What an idea! Klaatu says, I'm impatient with stupidity. My people have learned how to live without war. The universe grows smaller every day. The threat of aggression by any group anywhere can no longer be tolerated. There must be security for all, or no one can be secure. This does not mean giving up any freedom, except for the freedom to act irresponsibly. Your ancestors knew this when they made laws to govern themselves and hired policemen to enforce them. We have an organization for the complete elimination of aggression. This is Klaatu speaking. In matters of aggression, the robots, at the first sign of violence, act against the aggressor. The result is we are free of aggression and war, free to pursue more profitable enterprises, end quote. That was from Klaatu, the alien, in The Day the Earth Stood Still, the 1951 film. And Saul writes, mankind desperately, desperately needs something similar. Now, today, 2015. And he writes, the United Nations, formed after World War II, has failed miserably. It's hard even to imagine what the world will be like, free from acts of violence and war, because we are so lacking. We as a human race are so lacking in positive visions for a more enlightened world. Rather, we are inundated with images of doom and destruction from every quarter. I recently read the utopian novel, The Fifth Sacred Thing by Starhawk. Published 20 years ago, it's even more pertinent today. Set in post-apocalypse San Francisco, it suggests that nurturing nonviolence, is the way an enlightened society transforms itself in the face of mindless violence. Only if we can raise each other's consciousness, will things ever change for the better. We need a combination of both approaches. An international peacekeeping force must be developed to outlaw war and aggression. An international peacekeeping force must be developed to outlaw war and aggression. At the first sign, action would be swift and overwhelming. We must gather the brightest minds and hearts to guide us, people truly devoted to the common good, rather than a revolving door of career politicians rotating between government and big business, which is what we have today. Eliminating aggression Just feel those two words, eliminating aggression. Eliminating aggression, however, is not enough, as the root of terrorism is embedded in poverty and fear. Only when all people are able to live meaningful lives can there be lasting peace. Happy people do not become terrorists. Ending poverty and fear requires a paradigm change in how we believe the world should function. A paradigm change in how we believe the world should function. We need a collective adjustment. A collective meaning every human being, everyone on board. A collective adjustment if we wish to transform a society that equates money with free speech and believes corporations are people. I mean, come on. We need a collective adjustment if we wish to transform a society that equates money with free speech and believes corporations are people into one in which universal peace and prosperity become primary goals. Universal peace and prosperity become primary goals. This first step is for humanity to outlaw war so we can use our resources to take care of one another and our precious planet. So we can use these resources to take care of one another and take care of our precious Mother Earth and preserve it for future generations. That says it all in a nutshell. Outlaw war, outlaw aggression. What better way could there be? Doesn't that feel good? Doesn't that resonate? How does that feel for you? Outlaw war. What if war became an obsolete word, an obsolete activity, and aggression moving towards someone? As human beings, we are compassionate, loving, heartfelt, innately, meaning in our being, in as we are born loving, caring, compassionate beings. And we are born on this planet Earth. And this planet Earth is here to support us. She gives us everything we need. She gives us shelter. She gives us food. She gives us air. She gives us water. She protects us from the sun, yet we get just enough sunlight, that fire that we need. Our Earth is here to support us. And another article that my friend Saul wrote, I wanted to read because it's about Earth Day. And how we think about the Earth, because we, humanity and the Earth, have to survive together, have to do this together. It's not just about taking care of the Earth. It's also about taking care of humanity, lifting the consciousness of us, of me, of you, of your family, of your friends, of my family and my friends, lifting that consciousness up by beginning to care about peace, to beginning to care about how you live your life. If you pay attention to your own aggression, if you pay attention to your own war inside of yourself, that is the first step, in my estimation. When you notice anger coming up, when you notice acting out aggressively toward another person, that's a cue. For me, that's a cue anyway, to pay attention to, what am I afraid of? Because everything that is not love is fear. And acting aggressively toward another is about something I'm afraid of. It's about a deep-seated fear, very deep-seated fear. And I think what I might do is, a deep-seated fear, which if we start to pay attention to it, we can resolve that fear in ourselves. And when we do that, our energy shifts, our vibration ripples out, and more people begin to feel what we're feeling, what we are feeling. So let me just read this other article that Saul Solomon wrote. It's called Every Day Must Be Earth Day. That makes so much sense. I think I spoke about that at another time, that every day needs to be Valentine's Day, which is similar. Every day needs to be Earth Day. We need to care. We need to care about Earth, our mother, our planetary mother, every single day of our lives. What would that look like for you? So let me read this, and maybe you'll get some information about that, or get an intuition, or a little piece of information will come into your awareness that will be a little trigger for you that will help you to live like every day is Earth, live every day as it is Earth Day, or have every day be Earth Day. To Earth Day, I'm going to change this a little bit, because it was celebrated on April 22nd, but this holiday, like many others that last for only a day, has little effect on how we behave the rest of the year. Begun 45 years ago to call attention to the degradation of the planet, Earth Day has not prevented the tide of environmental destruction. For it to have true meaning, Earth Day must become a daily celebration. For it to have any true meaning, Earth Day to have any true meaning, Earth Day must become a daily celebration. Why not celebrate every day? For that to happen, again, a paradigm change needs to happen, needs to occur in our relationship with the Earth, my relationship to the Earth, your relationship to the Earth. Rather than raping and despoiling the planet, which is what we do now, we must become its caretakers. We can no longer view the Earth as a dead rock whose resources exist only for our exploration. They are too important for our continuing existence. For instance, in a sane world, fracking would be considered a crime against the planet. It's like raping the planet. It's time we recognize that the Earth is a living, breathing entity whose surface we human beings have dwelled on for only a brief period. Ancient people understood our place in the web of life, which brings me back to the primal drum. Ancient people understood our place in the web of life. What they didn't know is that the Earth, as far into the universe as we can now see, is the only planet that supports life as we know it. All forms of human suffering stem from this central disconnect. All forms of human suffering stem from this central disconnect. When we forget the primary reason we are here is to care for each other and to care for the planet, human life loses its value. When we care more about skin color and religion than quality of life for all people, gross economic and social imbalances prevail. When we lose our humanity, all life forms are devalued, and we find ourselves in the mess we're in. Various societies have declarations of independence and other guidelines that set standards of behavior. But who speaks for the Earth and for our common humanity? The following Declaration of Interdependence suggests a common set of beliefs integral to our survival, values that may still help restore the Earth to the state of balance and harmony that's our birthright. And so Saul Solomon, who wrote this article, calls this a Declaration of Interdependence, which sort of brings back and helps me to kind of connect in with Thich Nhat Hanh's interbeing, ways of interbeing, mindfulness, interbeing. We're all connected. We can't do one thing without it affecting many, many, many other aspects of other people and the Earth and other beings on the Earth. A Declaration of Interdependence. We hold these truths to be self-evident. Life on Earth is a privilege to be cherished and enjoyed. The Earth is a living entity and our collective mother, whose natural resources are integral to the survival of all species. Human beings are responsible for nurturing the resources of the Earth. No one has the right to upset the balance of nature by doing harm to other species or habitats. Every action and product must consider the consequences of its impact upon the balance of nature and its maintenance for future generations. And finally, the common purpose we share as human beings is to protect the integrity of the natural world and to caretake, celebrate, and evaluate each other and all living beings. That the Declaration of Interdependence by Saul Solomon. We are all connected. And how can we change? How can we begin to understand when we are in fear or when we are in love? I've been recently rereading this lovely book, which is called The Four Agreements by Don Miguel Ruiz. And it's called A Toltec Wisdom Book, A Practical Guide to Personal Freedom. When we talk about personal freedom, that is exactly what Saul is talking about as to how we can take care of the earth and what we need to do to outlaw war and aggression, to bring our own personal freedoms to bear and up and here and present. And in this book, Don Miguel Ruiz, in the beginning, he explains the Toltec point of view, which is an ancient Mexican dialect or ancient Mexican peoples, indigenous peoples from Mexico. They're called the Toltec peoples. And I'm going to read about the Toltec here because their point of view sheds light on how we can eliminate war, eliminate aggression by eliminating our fears. So this is a very brief talk about the Toltec from Mexico, which is what this book is based on, their belief system. So thousands of years ago, the Toltec were known throughout southern Mexico as women and men of knowledge. Anthropologists have spoken of the Toltec as a nation or a race, but in fact, the Toltec were scientists and artists who formed a society to explore and conserve the spiritual knowledge and practices of the ancient ones. They came together as masters on Nahuals and students at Teotihuacan, the ancient city of pyramids outside Mexico City, known as the place where, quote, man becomes God, end quote. Over the millennia, the Nahuals, or masters, were forced to conceal the ancestral wisdom and maintain its existence in obscurity. European conquests, which we've all experienced here in this country, coupled with rampant misuse of personal power by a few of the apprentices, made it necessary to shield the knowledge for those who were not prepared to use it wisely or who might intentionally misuse it for personal gain. Fortunately, the esoteric Toltec knowledge was embodied and passed on through generations by different lineages of Nahuals, or masters. Though it remained veiled in secrecy for hundreds of years, ancient prophecies foretold the coming of an age when it would be necessary to return the wisdom of the people. Now Don Miguel Ruiz, a Nahual from the Eagle Knight lineage, has been guided to share with us the powerful teachings of the Toltec. Toltec knowledge arises from the same essential unity of truth as all the sacred esoteric traditions found around the world, which includes Christianity and Hinduism and Judaism, Buddhism, Jainism, all of the ancient esoteric traditions. Though it is not a religion, it honors all the spiritual masters who have taught on the earth, all the spiritual masters. While it does embrace spirit, it is most accurately described as a way of life distinguished by the ready accessibility of happiness and love. What? I'm going to read that one again. While it does embrace spirit, this Toltec way, it is most accurately described as a way of life distinguished by the ready accessibility of happiness and love. That is the basis of humanity's reason for being here. And moving on, the smoky mirror. The smoky mirror is an aspect that can show us how and why we are so fearful and how to step out of that fear. So this is just a brief introduction to this book that I wanted to share with you as a backup, as a sustaining, maybe a way of moving forward for you to look at how to overcome the fear that keeps us aggressive, that keeps us at war. 3,000 years ago, there was a human just like you and me who lived near a city surrounded by mountains. The human was studying to become a medicine man to learn the knowledge of his ancestors, but he didn't completely agree with everything he was learning, which is a good way to be. In his heart, he felt there must be something more. One day, as he slept in a cave, he dreamed that he saw his own body sleeping. Any of you ever done that? Dream you saw your own body sleeping? He came out of the cave on the night of the new moon. The sky was clear, and he could see millions of stars. Come up to my neck of the woods in New Hampshire, and you can see millions of stars. Then something happened inside of him that transformed his life forever. He looked at his hands. He felt his body. And he heard his own voice say, "I am made of light. I am made of stars." He looked at the stars again, and he realized that it's not the stars that create light, but rather light that creates the stars. "Everything is made of light," he said. "And the space in between isn't empty." And he knew that everything that exists is one living being, and that light is the messenger of life. Because it is alive and contains all information. This was 3,000 years ago. Then he realized that although he was made of stars, he was not those stars. "I am in between the stars," he thought. So he called the stars the Tonal and the light between the stars the Nagual. And he knew that what created the harmony and space between the two is life or intent. Without life, the Tonal and the Nagual could not exist, which means that the light and the space between the life could not exist without life. Life is the force of the absolute, the supreme, the creator, who creates everything. This is what he discovered. Everything in existence is a manifestation of the one living being we call God. Everything, excuse me, is God. And he came to the conclusion that human perception is merely light perceiving light. He also saw that matter is a mirror. Everything is a mirror that reflects light and creates images of that light. And the world of illusion, the dream, is just like smoke, which doesn't allow us to see what we really are. The real us is pure love, pure light, he said. The real us is pure light, pure love. This is the truth. This realization changed his life. Once he knew what he really was, he looked around at other humans and the rest of nature, and he was amazed at what he saw. He saw himself in everything, in every human, in every animal, in every tree, in the water, in the rain, in the clouds, and in the earth. And he saw that life mixed the tonal, or the light, and the nagual, or the space between the light, in different ways to create billions of manifestations of life. In those few moments, he comprehended everything. He was very excited, and his heart was filled with peace. He could hardly wait to tell his people what he had discovered. But there were no words to explain it. He tried to tell the others, but they could not understand. They could see that he had changed, that something beautiful was radiating from his eyes and his voice. They noticed that he no longer had judgment about anything or anyone. He was no longer like anyone else. He could understand everyone very well, but no one could understand him. They believed that he was an incarnation of God, and he smiled when he heard this, and he said, "It is true. I am God. But you are also God. You are the same, you and I. We are images of light. We are God." But still the people didn't understand him. He had discovered that he was a mirror for the rest of the people, a mirror in which he could see himself. "Everyone is a mirror," he said. He saw himself in everyone, but nobody saw him as themselves. And he realized that everyone was dreaming, but without awareness, without knowing what they really are. They couldn't see him as themselves because there was a wall of fog or smoke between the mirrors. And that wall of fog was made by the interpretation of images of light, the dream of humans. Then he knew that he would soon forget all that he had learned. And he wanted to remember all that vision. He wanted to remember all the visions he had had. He wanted to remember those. So he decided to call himself Smoky Mirror, so that he would always know that matter is a mirror, and the smoke in between is what keeps us from knowing what we are. He said, "I am the smoky mirror because I am looking at myself in all of you, but we don't recognize each other because the smoke in between us. The smoke is the dream, and the mirror is you, the dreamer. We are all dreaming this dream that we call life, and when we can have an amazing experience, when we can really understand that we are love and we are light, we can have an amazing shift, a shift to knowing that we are living, we live forever. We are, as he said, God. That sounds blasphemous, but we are not only made in the image of God, we are that light, we are that consciousness that is God. And it is the smoke in between the mirror that is keeping us from the love that and the happiness and the joy that is our birthright, that is the way, the only way to overcome aggression, to overcome war, is to begin the process for each one of us, for you and for me, to realize and to work toward how I can be happy, how I can live in a loving, caring way for myself, but also for you and for all of humanity, but more importantly, for the whole earth. The whole earth needs us, needs our consciousness to rise back up to that place where we are the light, where we live from that place, as the smoky mirror mentioned or talks about, where he could see himself as the light and the space between the light, which is God, which is where, how we raise our consciousness up into being truly the manifestation of God and the light and the love that we truly are. This is how life changes. This is the way, one by one, or thousands by thousands, or millions by millions of people, as we rise up and stop our judgments of another, based on their religion, based on their color of their skin, based on their poverty level. As we stop these judgments, the most important judgment to stop is ourselves, our own mind story playing over and over and over again. If I had time to read the whole book, that's what the rest of the book is about, how we as human beings became trained to believe in fear, how we became trained to not know that we are the light. This is a training process, and he calls it domestication. We have been, as human beings, domesticated into thinking we need to be afraid and ashamed and judge things. We do not have to do that. That is not who we truly are. And so the four agreements, before we run out of too much of time, I wanted to just mention the four agreements that he talks about in the rest of the book are very powerful agreements that if we can, and he talks about what he means by agreements, which are based on the domestication of humanity. When we can live from, or if we can live from these four agreements that we have made, changing the agreements that we did make to these new agreements to live by, we can live happy, we can become the light, we can know who we truly are, and we can shift the earth from being aggression, full of aggression and war and terrorism, to being one of loving thy neighbor and happiness and joy, being what makes us prosperous rather than the machine of war and aggression. And so the four agreements that he writes about in the rest of this book are: be impeccable with your word. Now, he speaks deeply in this book about the word. Speak with integrity. Say only what you mean. Avoid using the word to speak against yourself or to gossip about others. Now, that is key. The word, because we think about ourselves over and over, day after day, in our mind, about ourselves, putting myself down, judging myself worse than anyone else could ever judge me. So be impeccable with the word means stop my own judgments in my own mind. That's one thing. But also stop the judgments of others. And stop gossiping. Stop pointing the finger and saying, look at that over there. That is worthless energy. So use the power of your word in the direction of truth and love. That's the first agreement. The next agreement, these are not in any order. This is one that I work on constantly on myself because it seems like something is doable for me, but all four are necessary. Actually, the first agreement, the first one, to be impeccable with your word, if you can master that one, the others fall in place. So the next agreement, don't take anything personally. And I've spoken about that on the show many times. Nothing others do is because of you. If someone's having a bad day, it's not because of you. If someone's angry at you, it's not because of you. If someone is hurting another person, it's not because of you. What others say and do is a projection of their own reality, their own dream. When you are immune to the opinions and actions of others, you won't be the victim of needless suffering. The next agreement, don't make assumptions. Finding the courage to ask questions and to express what you really want. That's a hard one because who asks questions around here? I know I don't ask a lot of questions. So find the courage to ask questions and express what you really want. You have to know what you really want to express it, so learn about what you really want. Communicate with others as clearly as you can to avoid misunderstandings, sadness, and drama. And with just this one agreement, you can completely transform your life. With each of these agreements, you can completely transform your life. And the fourth agreement, which makes sense, always do your best. Always do your best. We think we're doing our best, but really we're not totally doing our best. Your best is going to change from moment to moment, and it will be different when you're healthy as opposed to when you're sick. Under any circumstances, simply do your best and you will avoid self-judgment, self-abuse, and regret. So there you have it, a way to heal the earth, a way to bring freedom and joy and love back into this earth plane, back into humanity. In a nutshell, those are the four agreements. And thank you, Saul, for those wonderful articles that he wrote that I read to you on the show. I hope you enjoyed the show today. Next week, Christiana Rodriguez will be back hosting the show, and I will probably be co-hosting with her just as she gets her feet wet in taking over this program. And so until next time, I hope you can join me for a drum building workshop between now and then, or if you want to get in touch with me, my email or my website is on your screen. So it's time to take care of the earth, take care of humanity, and learn how to love each other in freedom, in peace, and in joy. Until next time, remember, your heart knows the way.